Good afternoon. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your grace and your mercy. We seek your presence in this hour of bereavement. We know that you are God of love and a covenant keeping. So we find our refuge and our solace in you. You are Jehovah Jireh, our provider. You are Eroi, the God who sees me and knows me in my hour of need, whether I'm in the valley or on the mountaintop. So our petition is that you provide peace of heart and comfort and divine understanding to this family in this hour. Further, we pray that we be of a mindset that we continually seek your face and that we pursue the salvation plan that come through your Son, Jesus the Christ. Amen. We are here today to pay tribute to Debbie Michelle Phillips. I guess her name is Deborah, but we call her Debbie. And I used to say the whole name Debbie Phillips. I mean, but we're here to do that. So the family appreciates you and the comfort that you have given them. However, due to considerations of the family have, we're going to have to expedite the program. So we ask for your patience and your courtesy as we do so. Amen. First, there's going to be some housekeeping. If you look at your program, are we going to have the Old Testament? Carlotta Evans. Veronica Phillips is going to do the New Testament. Bernie Shortimer is going to read the obituary.
She's not here. We got it. Keep on.
Brenton.
Yes, sir.
Tribute. Amen. And we're going to move right along. We're going to start with the Old Testament reading by Carlotta Evans. Amen.
Good evening, family. The Old Testament scripture for today is Psalms 23. Lots of you remember as youngsters that you just had to learn it. You didn't understand it. It was just words that you had to learn. So today, with this occasion, we are hopeful that the meaning of the words will stick with us and provide comfort for us. Psalms 23, a psalm of David. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Blessings to the reader and the hearers of his word.
Good afternoon, family, friends, and loved ones. I will read the word of the Lord from 1 Corinthians, the 13th chapter, the 4th through the 8th verses, and the 13th verse. Love is patient and kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. Love never ends. So now faith, hope, and love abide these three, but the greatest of these is love.
We're going to move on our program. It calls for the reading of the obituary.
We're going to go. This is not the original plan, but I think I can do this. Because if nothing else, I know my sister. And she had a full and wonderful life. Yes, we called her Debbie, Deborah. She was ours. She was amongst the second graduating class of Piper High School in 1974. But for elementary school, she went to Larkdale. Middle school, she went to Everglades. And we, as sisters, brothers, cousins, uncles, my Uncle James, my cousins, they're all here. We all spent lots of time in Westwood Park with our grandmother, Annie Phillips, and the other family members. Debbie and I enrolled in the unit secretary class and completed it in Hollywood. Afterwards, we went to work at Broward, what we called at that time Broward General Medical Center. We were unit secretaries. We started together June 14th, 1976. And I retired last year. Debbie remained there. She said to me when I retired, "Are you leaving me?" And you all know Debbie's and her wonderful voice. And it was like, yes, I'm leaving you, but I'm leaving Broward Health, but I'm not leaving you. So you'll follow me shortly. But life had a different path. Debbie's employment at Broward Health spanned over 45 years. She spent the last 20 plus years as a senior ambulatory business specialist for Comprehensive Care Center, and many of her co-workers are here today, and thank you for being present. They were her second family. If you knew Debbie, you knew her son, Devin. Devin was the center of her life. Debbie had an infectious smile and laugh and a very distinctive voice. I often try to imitate it, but I cannot. I cannot do that. She loved to shop, and especially thrift stores. She and my mom had this thing about thrift stores that I just really can't understand. But I'll hang with them, you know. I'll do almost anything I have to do. I cannot remember when Debbie started wearing wigs. But she had this fashion for hair, and she just made it look so natural. I can remember a time when she would take it off and she would say, "Here, put it on, see what it looks like." Didn't work. Did not work. But she really had a fashion for it. She loved the color purple. Debbie was tall, and she had this long, lean body from many years. And she could stroll down a runway like no one else could. I can remember when we went to John Robert Powers, and there was me, and there was Debbie. There was Debbie, and there was me. So we were sitting there once, and they were talking about how old you was, and I forgot I had a birthday. And she was like, no, no, we can't be the same age. So I was like, oh, I had a birthday. She's like, yes, okay. So I was just a little bit older. When we would walk down the runway, she did it with such grace. And then there was me. Well, the story is told. She could take a nap. And I would be so upset with her. I mean, I'm up 6 o'clock in the morning. Where we gotta go? Nowhere. What we gotta do? Nothing. And she could sleep. And I would be mad because I couldn't do it. But she was good at it. She didn't waste time. But yes, she could sleep. She was there to get her rest. We played backgammon. I would say more, she played backgammon. I couldn't understand it. The white tiles, the black tiles, they made absolutely no sense in my mind. But she was very good at it. She was an avid backgammon player. And many of you may be saying today, the younger folks, what's backgammon? I say Google it. Yes, I'd say Google it. Debbie read romance novels and mystery novels. She would just take a book and she would just read and read and read. And she would nap. But that was Debbie. Our mom, Dorothy Phillips Mitchell, our grandparents, Robert Phillips, Annie Lee Phillips, our uncle, Andrew Hughes, and Matthew Hughes, all preceded her in death. On October the 31st, my sister Debbie passed away. She will greatly, greatly be missed by all of us, but she will remain in our hearts and minds. What she has given us will withstand the test of times. She leaves to celebrate her life and her memories, her son Devin, her favorite sister Sharon, her favorite sister Beverly, her favorite sister Annette, her favorite sister Regina, her favorite sister Joy. Did I get all of the favorite sisters? Who did I miss, Annette? Joy? Oh, you're not favorite. Okay, let's do that again. Sharon, Beverly, Annette, Regina, Joy. That's all of the sisters. Oh, excuse me, Joy, correction. Joy was her favorite baby sister. And then she had three favorite brothers. Jeffrey, Alvin, and Corey. Jeffrey was her favorite big brother. Corey was her favorite baby brother. But we were all favorites. You know, you say, why favorites? Well, we had this little family thing that we had going, that who was the favorite? Well, I'm a favorite. Well, I'm a favorite. So we're all favorites. Her nieces and nephews, as you can continue to read on your own, there was a host of nieces and nephews and cousins and uncles and friends. So I will leave you to continue to read on your own. I know I may have strayed from the traditional reading of the obituary, but now you know my sister from my point of view.
Good afternoon, friends and family. I know this is a funeral, but the young lady that I knew will be slightly offended. Let's try this again. Good afternoon, friends and family. That's a lot better for my girl. It's a lot better. So my name is Brenton Wright. I met Debbie in 2001 when I started my long journey at Broward Health, and I was there for about 20 years. We worked in a department called Ambulatory Services at the time. Although we didn't work in the same building, I would see Debbie every time I visited her building. She always had that affectionate, infectious smile. I never forgot those words from day one and walking past her office. And forgive me, before I make the comment that she made, to get to know Brenton, to get to know Debbie, if you know Debbie, to know this is a funeral, we're not going to cry today. We're going to celebrate the life this young lady lived, okay? So I'm going to tell you something that she said to me. First words to me, boy, come here with your fine self. I looked at her, and then she stood up. Then I realized my height, and I looked at how tall she was. I said, yes, ma'am. Debbie had a presence about herself. Tall and demanding. Quiet but walk with a big stick. Her tall presence always brought about a level of intimidation for many. Debbie worked at Broward Health, as her big sister said, for 45 years plus. Now, that in itself was simply amazing. I remember giving her, I had the pleasure of emceeing a lot of the events that Broward Health had, and I actually gave her a 40th year service award plaque, and that was an honor for me. I was traumatized after receiving a phone call from Big Sister Sharon on my way to work that my girl had passed on. My understanding was this family had suffered a lot of losses over the past couple of years, and my heart certainly goes out to you. Family and friends, I'm here to tell you, we're all here only for a season. But we will all spend something called eternity with the Father above, providing that we live a life of righteousness and having a personal relationship with our Heavenly Father. No, I'm not an ordained pastor, I'm not a minister, but I'm a believer in the Most High. So that is not to offend anyone here, but I stand where I believe. To Debbie's favorite sisters, as affectionately called by Sharon, Beverly, let me see, because I'm just meeting the family for the first time. Beverly, raise your hand, Beverly. Beverly, where's Beverly? I'm speaking to you, Beverly. Beverly, Annette, let me see, there you go. Regina. Hey, Regina, like the blondie. And Joy, Miss Joy, I understand you're the favorite sister, correct? Winking at me, I like that, okay. And Debbie's favorite brothers. Jeffrey, where are you, sir? Alvin, I met Alvin last night. Mr. Alvin, he's something else right there. And Corey, where's Corey? Good to see you in the back, Corey. Unfortunately, I know your pain too well because I lost his sister in 2012. And I promise you, I know what that pain feels like. Not telling you I'm sorry, I just know what the pain feels like. I simply encourage you to cherish her fond memories in your hearts. Debbie's spirit lives on forever. I met little bro and Alvin last night for the very first time. I call you little bro, so forgive me. Last time I approached him, and he had a look on his face when I approached him, like, who are you? I introduced myself. He shared with me quite few memories of his beloved sister, Debbie. He smiled while sharing his story with Debbie, and I would like to share with you guys a few of his intimate moments. He shared with me quite a few memories of his beloved sister. He smiled while sharing his story with Debbie, always having a car when he was little. How she would take him and other siblings on car rides. He remembers the top being down and them just riding along with him, sitting on somebody's lap. Now, I'm curious. Alvin didn't share with me whose lap he was sitting on. Whose lap or the sibling he sat on? All of y'all laps. Okay, Alvin, you didn't say who, but they say, your big brother said all of them. Okay, cool. How she would take him and other sitting on rides. He remembers the top being down and just riding with them, sitting on. And I always wondered, I said to him, top being down? Man, who had a car with top being down? He never answered that question. He also had fond memories of his lovely sister, Debbie. And many of you know for Broad Hill family, might not notice about Debbie, but I learned this last night. Apparently, Debbie was a fighter. Am I right, siblings? Okay, all right. Mr. Brother Alvin shared with me kindly that his dearest sister beat up similar girl one time. I beat her to a pulp. Debbie, forgive me. I'm just telling the dirt that your brother told me, okay? I believe Debbie got those disciplinary actions, skills from her grandmother, I believe, by the name of Annie. Am I saying that correctly? Sister Annie, God loves you. I believe they call life lessons. And at least that's what my grandmother called it. Finally, my heart's touched. Debbie's son, Devin. I love you, brother. I had a conversation with our brother Devin last night, and he described his mom as a tough and very aggressive woman, but very loving mom. He knew that she loved him, but she was very tough with him at all times. When she was mad, she would turn everything into an argument, which he never won. Breaking news, family and friends, from breaking news. This is from Devin. I got this text about 2 hours ago. I was informed that at one point during an incident, Debbie backed down two thieves with some type of mace. Am I correct, family? Or Devin, you the only one can speak to that? Or you the only one can speak to that? Or y'all don't know nothing about that, family? Oh, little sis, very favorite sis know about that. Yeah, Debbie backed down two thieves with some mace. Well, that definitely speaks to her toughness, I believe. Devin, speaking from my heart right now, sir, I lost my mom about 5 years ago. Again, unfortunately, I know the pain all too well. That's all you have. That is all you would have for the rest of your life is certainly the memory of your mom. So I encourage you to cherish the memory of your mom. Know that your mom was a great woman and loved many and loved by many. And speaking with Devin last night, I asked him one simple question. If you can do one thing at this moment to remember and honor your mom, what would that be? He simply said that he would like to read a poem to her. Bear with me as I read a quick poem that's from the heart of a son honoring his mother that he sent to me late last night. It's simply entitled, Your Mother. Although you cannot hear her voice or see her smile no more, your mother walks beside you, still just as she did before. She listens to your stories and she wipes away your tears. She wraps her arms around you and she understood your fears. It's just she isn't visible to see with human eye. But talk to her in silence and her spirit will reply. You'll feel the love she has for you. You'll hear it in your heart. She left the human body which your souls will never part. Friends and family, as I honor my sister that I love dearly, we all cherish her life on this earth. As I stated earlier, just know that the only way for us to be with her in spirit at some point is certainly to live a righteous life and do as the good book says that we should do, love one another. I encourage your family to certainly love on each other. This is a tough time. But I bid you well, I bid you love, and as we cherish the memories of my beautiful sister, your beautiful loved one, may God continue to be with all of you and give you the peace in your heart, and I love you all. Thank you.
Thank you, Brenton. Like I say, we're going to be brief today. These are words of comfort. And I think my title is going to be on love, since we have expressed some love today, amen? And you can look at the audience. We know that there's some love in your hearts because you are here. Amen? Sometimes when I speak, I ask questions. I don't always give the answers. Sometimes I just give the questions and allow you to come to your own conclusion. So my question today for right now is, do you know of, have you heard of, a virtuous woman?
Amen.
Would you know one when you see one?
Amen.
I'll get some paraphrases from Proverbs. But this is what you'll find if you find a virtuous woman. You will find that she is more excellent and more precious than gold or silver or some Benjamins. That means you got something if you find yourself a virtuous woman. Her characteristics and her behavior is one might find that she will, at late at night, that she will, early in the morning, that she will get up and she will fix food for and comfort for her household. A virtuous woman, even if she had to go out and bring it in herself, amen? For her own earning, she would make provisions. Within her, you will find courage and become strong, that she will become strong. And she will spend long, long hours at a job. Even though that wasn't the best of jobs, it didn't pay it well, she will still do it. A virtuous woman, she would extend her hand to the poor. She would extend her hand to the needy. And I can see Deborah just working those applications for those people at the site. Some of them didn't know, well, I can't get in that. Some of them didn't know what they were doing, but she helped them out, amen. Amen, got the people what they needed. She will be fearless and in her provision and protection for her household. She has strength and dignity in her clothing, wore her clothes. Her smile was for the future. She opened her mouth with wisdom. And her tongue would teach in kindness, a virtuous woman. Or they would speak of her as a noble person. Her children would speak very kindly of her and praise her. That was a virtuous woman. But if you knew Debbie, you would know the virtuous woman. So you would know what I'm talking about. Now, but getting back to love, let us talk a little bit about love. Because since it is our theme, if I look at Matthew 22:36-44, when the ubiquitous day asked our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, what was the greatest commandment of all time? And what did he say? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, your mind, and your soul. And say, this is the greatest commandment. And the second one unto that is to what? Love your neighbor as yourself. He said, if you do this, then all the laws and the prophets are fulfilled. If you love, and you know that family is also neighbors, right? Amen. Sometimes we get into situations in the past where there becomes some friction in the family, and we forget that we should love them as our neighbor. Love them as we love ourselves. Amen. For in the movies, I seen this long, long time ago. I don't even remember the name of the movie. It says that love is never having to say you're sorry. Never having to say you're sorry. We won't unpack that today. We don't have time. We got to get out of here. See, but when I look at some other things, I look at Paul in 1 Corinthians 13:13. He say, "Now that all remains is faith, which is what? Abiding trust in God and his promises." He say, "There is hope, which is what? Confidence and expectation of eternal salvation, and love, unselfish love for others, growing out of God's love for me." Of these three, he said, love is the greatest of all. So if you have love and you're loving your God with all your heart, your mind, and your soul, and loving your neighbors, loving your family as yourself, you have fulfilled the laws and the prophets. Fresh and blood will not enter the kingdom of God. See, the perishable hath to put on the imperishable. The mortal hath to push on the immortal. So death will have no sting if you put your trust and your faith in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And one of the commandments that Christ gave us was that what we should do is to love one another. So that's a new commandment added on to the law and the prophets, that we need to love one another. So we know this, what? In John 3:16, we know this is, if we learn to love the Lord, and we will really know what love is all about. If we get to John 3:16, it says what? That he gave his only begotten son. Will have everlasting life. See, that love keep coming on again and again. So in our Heavenly Father, we thank him for our love and his grace and his mercy. And you know, this is not a traditional homecoming, but as Brenton say, this is a statement of love. This is what we memorialize our beloved Debbie. And you know, sometimes preacher tell you don't cry about the passing of someone. And so this is my sister Sharon told me that it's not going to be a sad occasion. It's going to be expeditious. But let me say this here. Say sometime, maybe not today, but maybe an hour from now, or a week from now, or a year from now. When you do what? When you find yourself excited about BOGOs. If you find yourself going to a thrift shop and being happy. If you find yourself playing backgammon, or you find yourself seeing a backgammon board, if you find yourself with a bunch of wigs and be all over the place and scattered out and you sharing with your family and friends, if you find yourself, get this in, if you feel like they would say, when she meets you, you was not a stranger, because she come up and talk to you like she known you all your life. When you find yourself in those positions, and then when you find yourself thinking about these things, when you will think about her and the memory that you have of her, then you begin to smile, and then you begin to laugh, and then you begin to cry, and then you begin to smile, and then you begin to laugh, and then you begin to cry. Then you will thank God about the love that he has given us, that he will share Debbie, and she will be a part of her life. Because God is love, and we will remember that love, and we should take that love into the rest of our life. Amen, amen, and amen. We're going to do the benediction. Oh, where did he go? All right, we want to do the benediction and then acknowledgement. Okay. So may God the Father, his merciful love, and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the conviction of the Holy Spirit, keep us from this day forward. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. And now, no, we didn't. I just skipped all over that. So it's not too late. Amen. We're going to have some reflections by a friend, which is Edwina McCray, followed by a co-worker, Maria Roscoe. Amen.
Sister Debbie is my girl. I've been knowing Debbie, we graduated together. And one day she was at my mom's house with me. The doc came there. That's when I found out I was kinky. Because doc said, yeah, I was kinky. And Annie was at home and she walked around there. So I just want to let y'all know, I love Debbie like my sister. I've been with Debbie for years. And I don't know how I'm going to make it with that. This is my son, he's going to read something. And I don't think I could read. The early one morning.
Can the church say amen?
Amen.
Early one morning, I cried when you passed away. I still cry today. Although I love you dearly, I couldn't make you stay. A golden heart stopped beating. Hard working hands at rest. God broke my heart to prove to me and us it only takes the best.
Amen.
Love, family, and Edwina McCray.
Amen.
Good afternoon, everyone. As I stand to reflect as a co-worker, I would like to ask all Broward Health employees, past and present, to please stand, if you can, if you will. Surely Debbie has left a lasting impression on each of us. If I was security, Mr. Barrington, I would say that Debbie made me laugh and she spoke the truth. If I was case manager, Tamika Johnson, I would say she was firm and stern. If I was medical assistant, Maggie, I would say that she didn't hold grudges. If I was her fellow business specialist, Miss Dorothy, I would say in the end, we became buddies. We were all we had. If I was Latisse, our referral technician, I would say she was my friend. If I was Dr. Mel, I'd say that was just one sweet old lady. And if I was Brandis, I would say she lived for Devin. I'm sorry, y'all. Y'all can have a seat if you like. I met Debbie in 2007 when my journey with Broward Health started. And it went a little something like this. Miss Grant told me to learn every part of the clinic.
And
Miss Grant is her former boss. I do see her over there. Hi, Miss Grant. When I got to Debbie's office, I said, it's my turn to sit with you for a few days so you can teach me what you do. And at that time, she was doing those W-80 applications. She looked at me and she said, if you think I'm going to show you everything I know and you're gonna have my job next week, you must be crazy. So I sat quietly and she said nothing. And that's how our relationship started. Some days we were on good terms and some days we were on good terms. But Debbie was real. She didn't sugarcoat anything. She was loyal, as Brenton told you, as Ms. Crum said to you, and as you have read, she served Broward Health for over 45 years. That's a long time. That's longer than I've been alive. In 20 of those years, at least, she worked for Comprehensive Care Center. During the pandemic is when we became the closest. There was a toilet paper shortage, and she would tell Corliss that she needed the toilet paper. So I had a little extra at home, and I brought her that toilet paper. I don't know if her heart softened that day or not. But some days I would come in with salad and all the fixings. She loves salad. And I say, Debbie, I have us lunch, but you have to make it. Oh, really? But she would go to the kitchen and she would prepare it. Some days I come with 4 cans of tuna, the eggs already boiled and everything else. And Debbie would make the tuna for us all to eat. In that way, I saw her as a servant. She enjoyed fixing the food. Somebody said she was the kitchen monitor, but I just saw her as a servant. When I adopted the first 2 children that I adopted, she told me that I must have been out of my mind. And I guess I am, because I went and I adopted the 3rd one during the pandemic. It was on the internet and everybody joined in from work. But Debbie came by. She held the baby and of course she got a plate of food. But after that day, when Debbie would go to the food pickups, She always thought about me and my children. She would say, Maria, I have bananas. I have apples. I have this and I have that. But you better tell your oldest son to come out and get it because I'm not lifting any boxes. And that's just who Debbie was. Surely we all have felt the impact of losing her. From the last day she was in the office, it hasn't been the same. You walk by, you can hear people talking about her. You can see some people drop a tear or two. But then you laugh because that's what she made you do. So I just want to encourage you all. Remember Debbie and smile. Thank you, Debbie.
Ms. Crum, do you want anyone else to speak? Does someone, all right.
Favorite sister, Regina.
Favorite sister, you got to get the favorite sister, amen.
I just
want to
talk about my sister, Debbie.
They can't hear you.
Okay, let me hear you.
Of course.
Good job. Go get my lawyers. Okay. Debbie was my second oldest sister. She was the tallest one in the family. And I have to say, she had the most fashion. She was a diva. She wore these high heel shoes, and she wore makeup from Fashion Fair and designer clothes. And so, she would get up in the morning like before seven. They would get up early in the morning, her and Sharon, and they'd be getting ready for work. I got to get to work on time. So I said, okay, I'll wait till she go get ready to go to work. And she'd pull out that driveway, her and Sharon be bellowing down that highway. And when they come back in the evening, I said, did you make it to work on time? I was just a little girl. They said, yeah. I was like, yay. They made it to work on time, and they did. You see how long their careers spanned it. And they were inseparable. They worked so long together, so hard together. She always said, my sister is going to take care of me. I was like, Debbie, who's going to take care of you? Sharon. My sister this and my sister that. She can go to Sharon for anything. And then when Debbie got sick, Sharon worked so many hours. She was exhausted. Sharon would make sure that all Debbie bills was paid. Sharon would go to the rent office. I said, Sharon, would you keep going to the rent office for every day? Every day you go there to speak to Maria. Well, I just want to see if they have a downstairs apartment because Debbie couldn't walk well. And then in the end, she couldn't walk at all. So Sharon just wanted to make sure she got that first floor apartment. And so I said, you can make a call. She didn't. She made sure Debbie's clothes was clean. She made sure her house was clean. And she made sure that she had money in her pocket. And also the staff at CCC, they would give her money because I would look in her wallet and see how much she got today. They would bring her money. I mean, she was just so well taken care of. And I want to give a special thanks to my brother Jeffrey. Now, we don't talk a lot, and we don't get along well because both of us have bad tempers. So I called him, and I said, well, I'll call him. I called him, and he said, you know, Regina, Debbie needed some help. And I said, well, what does she need help with? And he said she needed some money to pay a bill. And I said, and you gave it to her? I said, because I wouldn't. And he said, I have to give it to her. I had to give it to her. He said, that's my sister. And my heart just softened. I said, okay. And so she didn't have to ask. I went over and I would help her. And, you know, I gave her some money for the first time. And so, and then she called me like 2:00 in the morning. She said, Regina, I cannot get up and walk. I said, okay, Debbie. Call 911. I said, I'll be on my way. Because I was just up 2:00 in the morning, just walking around. And so I got there. The paramedics came. He stayed a while. And I kind of looked at them and I wanted to say, take her to the hospital. But I said, I'm not going to say anything. And they found out, you know, something, and they helped the doctor along the way to expedite her care. And the doctor told us some things. I didn't really listen. And I said, well, I just wanted to see her make it. and I kept encouraging her and giving her hope. She was so sick of us giving her encouragement and hope. She said, "Could you just please leave me alone?" And I was like, okay, Debbie, wake up. Regina, I just went to sleep. Now it's you. First it was the phone, now it's you. And I said, you know what, okay. So I didn't wake up. She said, I like to sleep late. And she said, Sharon is early. I said, yeah, Sharon is early. She make her appointments. Just get up, Debbie, and do it. Well, I don't like to. I said, get up and do it anyway. And so we would encourage her to eat, encourage her to drink. And even when the physical therapist came at St. Anthony's to get her up and give her physical therapy, she said, I'm not getting up. She said, okay, we'll do the exercise in bed. Debbie said, could you just please leave me alone? And so she didn't take no for an answer. She didn't back down. She just helped Debbie do her exercise till she really couldn't do it anymore. And I just wanted to say, I knew she was leaving, but my sister didn't realize that she was leaving Sharon. And I said to my daughters when I got home Sunday, I said, my sister's gonna leave here. If it's not tonight, she'll be leaving here Monday morning. So I got up early Monday morning, and I paced around. I said, I can't go to the hospital because I can't be there by myself. Sharon said, well, you could have called me. Well, they called and they said that she was gone. And the staff at VITAS, which I am also an employee, I let them know. Some staff I didn't know. I said, I want you to take care of my sister, because I work for VITAS as well. And they did a very good job of taking care of Debbie. They didn't under-medicate her. They didn't over-medicate her. And she passed on. She was tired. And one thing I can say about you, that girl could dress, and she could walk in those high heels. She was bow-legged. And I would just love to see my sister dressed up. She can wear long hair, she can wear short hair, she can wear any style. And she was very a no-nonsense person. She didn't put up with a lot of foolishness, and she didn't let nobody push her around. And she could fight. One of the staff members for Elijah Bell, I think it was his aunt, she found out from Debbie that Debbie could fight. I'm gonna wrap it up. And Debbie beat her to a pulp. And there was another time Debbie had a job. When she first tried her hand at nursing, my Auntie Joan got her a job at Manor Pines Nursing Home. And I think it was Debbie's second shift. She either worked 11 to 7 or 3 to 11. And this patient hit Debbie in the face with his soiled diaper, knocked the glasses off. And when Debbie finished with him, Joan came back the next day and said, well, what happened to you? He said, I felt like a train ran over me. And that was the end of that. Okay, so that's it. Come on, Robin.
Thank you. Bell staff.
Good afternoon to everyone. On behalf of Mr. Elijah Bell and the Elijah Bell Funeral Home staff, we would like to say thank you to this family for entrusting us with your most precious gift, your loved one. It was indeed an honor and pleasure to serve you on today. Knowing that you could have chosen anyone, but the fact that you chose us does give us pleasure in serving you on today. And to each and every one of you that have come out on behalf of this family, we would like to say thank you, for we know that this time in the afternoon, you could have been anywhere, but the fact that you're here does show that your love for this family and your love for the loved one is enough. And I would ask that not only today, but continue to love on them, because we do find out that sometimes after today, the phone calls stop, the hugs stop, the checking on you stop, but don't stop doing that. Continue to love on each other and continue to check on each other. We will have a final viewing at this time, and in the essence of time, we would ask that you all follow the instructions, and also in the essence of time, you will have a chance to greet the family at the repast that is located at Lafayette Heart Park at 2851 Northwest 8th Road, Fort Lauderdale, Florida, 33311. That is on the back of your program. Again, in the essence of time, that will be your time to greet and the family. Also, there will be an intermit at Sunset Memorial Gardens, located at 3201 Northwest 19th Street, Fort Lauderdale, Florida, 33311. That is also on the back of your program. And also, in the essence of time, we would ask that once you all, at the time of the instructions of one of our funeral staffs, if you could gather all of your belongings as you view, we would ask that you exit the building so you can go ahead and get ready for the processional to process to the interment. So once you view, gather all your belongings as you will be exited out of the building in the essence of time. Also, I do see here pallbearers by the name of Robert Croom, Vincent Volontaire, Jarvis Phillips, Alvin Mitchell, Stephen Johnson, Brandon Freeman, Jeffrey Mitchell, with the assistance of Bell staff. Once you all view, if you could meet us in the foyer so you all can do your duties as pallbearers. At this time, we will go ahead and start the instructions. We will start with this side first, starting with the minister. You will exit out this door, come up the middle, exit out this door. The far left side, you will stand, you will start at the back row, you will come across. You will exit out the middle. Family, you will get instructed row by row so you all can stay seated at this time. Thank you all so much.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.